This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Old Norse was a North Germanic language that was spoken by inhabitants of Scandinavia and inhabitants of their overseas settlements during about the 9th to 13th centuries. The Proto-Norse language developed into Old Norse by the 8th century, and Old Norse began to develop into the modern North Germanic languages in the mid to late 14th century, ending the language phase known as Old Norse. These dates, however, are not absolute, since written Old Norse is found well into the 15th century. Old Norse was divided into three dialects: Old West Norse, Old East Norse, and Old Gutnish. Old West and East Norse formed a dialect continuum, with no clear geographical boundary between them. For example, Old East Norse traits were found in eastern Norway, although Old Norwegian is classified as Old West Norse, and Old West Norse traits were found in western Sweden. Most speakers spoke Old East Norse in what is present-day Denmark and Sweden. Old Gutnish, the more obscure dialectal branch, is sometimes included in the Old East Norse dialect due to geographical associations. It developed its own unique features and shared in changes to both other branches. The 12th century Icelandic Grey Goose Laws state that Swedes, Norwegians, Icelanders and Danes spoke the same language, Dansk Tunga, Danish tongue. Speakers of Old East Norse would have said Dansk Tunga. Another term used especially commonly with reference to West Norse, was Norrønt Mål, Nordic speech. Today Old Norse has developed into the modern North Germanic. Languages: Icelandic, Faroese, Norwegian, Danish and Swedish, of which Norwegian, Danish and Swedish retain considerable mutual intelligibility. In some instances the term Old Norse refers specifically to Old West Norse contents. 1. Geographical distribution. 2. Modern descendants. 3. Phonology. 31. Vowels. 32. Consonants. 33. Orthography. 34. Accent. 4. Phonological processes. 41. Oblaut. 42. Umlaut. 421. U-umlaut. 43. Breaking. 44. Assimilation or elision of inflectional. 5. Phonotactics. 51. Blocking of E, UU. 52. Apenthesis. 6. Grammar. 61. Gender. 611. Hierarchy. 62. Morphology. 7. Texts. 8. Dialects. 81. Old West Norse. 811. Old Icelandic. 812. Old Norwegian. 813. Greenlandic Norse. 814. Text example. 82. Old East Norse. 821. Old Danish. 822. Old Swedish. 823. Text example. 83. Old Gutnish. 831. Text example. 9. Relationship to other languages. 91. Relationship to English. 92. Relationship to modern Scandinavian languages. 10. See also. 101. Dialectal information. 11. Literature. 111. Introductions. 112. Dictionaries. 113. Grammars. 12. Notes. 13. References. 14. External links. Geographical distribution. The approximate extent of Old Norse and related languages in the early 10th century. Icelandic, Faroese, Norwegian and the extinct Norn language of Orkney and Shetland. The descendants of the Old East Norse dialect are the East Scandinavian languages of Danish and Swedish. Norwegian is descended from Old West Norse, but over the centuries it has been heavily influenced by East Norse, particularly during the Denmark-Norway Union. Among these, Icelandic and the closely related Faroese have changed the least from Old Norse in the last 1,000 years, although with Danish rule of the Faroe Islands, Faroese has also been influenced by Danish. Old Norse also had an influence on English dialects and Lowland Scots, which contain many Old Norse loanwords. It also influenced the development of the Norman language, and through it and to a smaller extent, that of modern French. Various other languages, which are not closely related, have been heavily influenced by Norse, particularly the Norman dialects, Scottish Gaelic and Irish Russian, Belarusian, Lithuanian, Finnish, Latvian and Estonian also have a number of Norse loanwords. The words Rus and Russia, according to one theory, may be named after the Rus people, a Norse tribe, see Rus name, probably from present-day East Central Sweden. The current Finnish and Estonian words for Sweden are Ruotsi and Rutsi, respectively. Of the modern languages, Icelandic is the closest to Old Norse written. Modern Icelandic derives from the Old Norse phonemic writing system. Contemporary Icelandic speakers can read Old Norse, which varies slightly in spelling as well as semantics and word order. However, pronunciation, particularly of the vowel phonemes, has changed at least as much as in the other North Germanic languages. Faroese retains many similarities but is influenced by Danish, Norwegian, and Gaelic Scottish and or Irish, although Swedish, Danish and the Norwegian languages have diverged the most, they still retain asymmetric mutual intelligibility. Speakers of modern Swedish, Norwegian and Danish can mostly understand each other without studying their neighboring languages, particularly if speaking slowly. The languages are also sufficiently similar in writing that they can mostly be understood across borders. This could be because these languages have been mutually affected by each other, as well as having a similar development influenced by Middle Low German phonology. This section contains IPA phonetic symbols without proper rendering support. You may see question marks, boxes, or other symbols instead of Unicode characters. Vowels. The vowel phonemes mostly come in pairs of long and short. The standardized orthography marks the long vowels with an acute accent in medieval manuscripts. It is often unmarked but sometimes marked with an accent or through gemination. All phonemes have, more or less, the expected phonetic realization. Old Norse had nasalized versions of all nine vowel places. These occurred as allophones of the vowels before nasal consonants and in places where a nasal had followed it in an older form of the word. Before it was absorbed into a neighboring sound, if the nasal was absorbed by a stressed vowel, it would also lengthen the vowel. These nasalizations also occurred in the other Germanic languages, but were not retained long. They were noted in the first grammatical treatise, and otherwise might have remained unknown. The first grammarian marked these with a dot above the letter. This notation did not catch on, and would soon be obsolete. Nasal and oral vowels probably merged around the 11th century in most of Old East Norse. 3. However, the distinction still holds in Dalecarlian dialects. 4. The dots in the following vowel table separate the oral from nasal phonemes. Generic vowel system. See 9th-12th centuries. Rounded high I-I-I-I-Y-Y-Y. O-O tilde low, low mid, O. By this time see Old Icelandic for the O. Mid EEOO stroke. History of Old Norse and Old Icelandic vowels. Proto-Germanic, Northwest Germanic, Primitive Old West Norse, Old Icelandic, First Grammarian, Later Old Icelandic. Example: Old Norse AA land, land. E men, men. A lotta, to let. E sex, six. Jo Jo Dieresis, scolder, shield. Y slingva, to sling. Ash mower, mothers. O fogel, fuggle, bird. I bine, gut bane, bone. E lasa, to loosen. Lost coma. Descended from Proto-Germanic, Z, and eventually developed into, R, as it already had done in Old West Norse. Fricative FV theta, S, H trill R approximant, JW lateral approximant L. The consonant digraphs HL, our, HN occurred word. Initially it is unclear whether they were sequences of two consonants with the first element realized as, H, or perhaps, X, or as single voiceless sonorants, L, R, and N, respectively in Old Norwegian, Old Danish and later Old Swedish. The groups HL, our, HN were reduced to plain L, R, N, suggesting that they were most likely realized as voiceless sonorants by Old Norse times. The pronunciation of HV is unclear, and may have been, X, the Proto-Germanic pronunciation, H, or, unlike the other three groups above, it was retained much longer in all dialects, and never developed into a voiceless sonorant in Icelandic, but instead hardened to a plosive, kv. This suggests that it was not a voiceless sonorant, but retained stronger frication orthography. Main article: Old Norse orthography. Unlike Proto-Norse, which was written with the elder Futhark, Runic Old Norse was originally written with the younger Futhark, which only had 16 letters because of the limited number of runes. The rune for the vowel U was also used for the vowels O, O and Y, and the rune for I was used for E. Medieval runes came into use some time later. As for the Latin alphabet, there was no standardized orthography in use in the Middle Ages. A modified version of the letter Wind called Vend was used briefly for the sounds U, V, and, with long vowels were sometimes marked with acutes, but also sometimes left unmarked or geminated. The standardized Old Norse spelling was created in the 19th century, and is for the most part phonemic. The most notable deviation is that the non-phonemic difference between the voiced and the voiceless dental fricative is marked. The oldest texts as well as runic inscriptions use exclusively long vowels are denoted with acutes. Most other letters are written with the same glyph as the IPA phoneme, except as shown in the table below. Accent. See also, Danish stad, Norwegian tonal stress, and Swedish tonal stress. This section needs expansion with, dating, etc. You can help by adding to it April 2010. Primary stress in Old Norse falls on the word stem, so that hyriar would be pronounced, hyriar, in compound words. secondary stress falls on the second stem, e.g. Larisvin, Li Swin. One modern Swedish, Danish, and Norwegian have two registers reflected in differing pronunciation of the stressed syllable of words in Swedish and Norwegian. The registers are reflected in different tones, i.e. through tonal word accent, while in Danish the difference is the presence or absence of stod, a glottal gesture considered a kind of creaky voice that seems to have been documented by Swedish sources as early as the 16th century. What is here called class 1 is reflected as tone 1 in Norwegian, acute accent in Swedish, and presence of stod in Danish, whereas class 2 words have tone 2 in Norwegian, grave accent in Swedish, and no stod in Danish. No sign of any tonal system is found in Icelandic or Faroese. Not all cognates occur in the same register classes in all three languages, partly due to language-specific restrictions on the contexts in which the two classes can occur. For example, stod can only occur in stressed words that have long vowels or end in a voiced consonant, whereas in Swedish and Norwegian, monosyllables can only take tone 1, acute accent in general. However, class 1 words are those that are monosyllabic in Old Norse, while class 2 words are those that are polysyllabic. Exceptions, including minimal pairs, have arisen for various reasons. Suffixing a definite article onto class 1 words does not change their class, suggesting that the register distinctions developed before the definite article fused with the noun, hence Old Norse and in the duck. Ablaut patterns are groups of vowels which are swapped, or ablauted, in the nucleus of a word. Strong verbs ablaut the lemma's nucleus to derive the past forms of the verb. This parallels English conjugation, where, e.g., the nucleus of sing becomes sang in the past tense and sung in the past participle. Some verbs are derived by ablaut, as the present in past verbs do by consequence of being derived from the past tense forms of strong verbs. Umlaut, see also, Germanic umlaut and Old Norse morphophonology. Umlaut or mutation is an assimilatory process acting on vowels preceding a vowel or semivowel of a different vowel backness in the case of I-umlaut and umlaut. This entails a fronting of back vowels, with retention of lip rounding in the case of U-umlaut. This entails labialization of unrounded vowels. Umlaut is phonemic and in many situations grammatically significant as a side effect of losing the Proto-Germanic morphological suffixes whose vowels created the umlaut allophones. Some y, y, o, o stroke, oi, and I, were obtained by I umlaut from u, u, o, o, a, o, and I, respectively. Others were formed via umlaut from u, u, a, and o. Some, y, o, o stroke, and all, were obtained by u umlaut from I, e, and a, respectively. See Old Icelandic for information on O, was obtained through a simultaneous U and I umlaut of A. It appears in words like gora, gura, gera, from Proto-Germanic garwajana, and commonly in verbs with a velar consonant before the suffix like sakva. Swedish noun jord mentioned above, and even I stem nouns and root nouns, such as Old West Norse mork mork in Icelandic in comparison with modern and Old Swedish mark breaking. See also, vowel breaking, or fracture, caused a front vowel to be split into a semivowel vowel sequence before a back vowel in the following syllable, while West Norse only broke E, East Norse also broke I. The change was blocked by a V, L, or R preceding the potentially broken vowel. One, some, ya, or, j, and, ya, or, j, result from breaking of e, and e, respectively. Assimilation or elision of inflectional, when a noun, pronoun, adjective, or verb has a long vowel or diphthong in the accented syllable and its stem ends in a single l, n, or s, the r or the elder r or z variant, in an ending is assimilated when the accented vowel is short, the ending is dropped. The nominative of the strong masculine declension and some I-stem feminine nouns uses one such r, oin r oin, becomes oin instead of oin r oin, but Karl r Carl remains Carl. Blaza, to blow, has blaze for you blow instead of blazer blaze. The rule is not hard and fast, with counter-examples such as vinr, which has the synonym vin, yet retains the unabsorbed version, and jotun, where assimilation takes place even though the root vowel, o, is short. Words with a final r in the word stem, such as vetr, do not add another r, as the sounds are already the same. The effect of the dropping usually results in the lack of distinction between some forms of the noun. In the case of vetr, the dropping renders the nominative and accusative singular and plural identical. The nominative of singular and nominative and accusative plural would otherwise have been vetar vinter, while the accusative singular would still have been vetr. This is because the third strong masculine declension, to which it belongs, marks the nominative singular and nominative and accusative plural, but not the accusative singular, with inflectional s phonotactics blocking of e, uui, j adjacent to I, e, their u umlauts, and a was not possible, nor u, v adjacent to u, o, their I umlauts, and o at the beginning of words. This manifested as a dropping of the initial j or v compare on or, ulfer, r with English word, wolf, year in inflections. This manifested as the dropping of the inflectional vowels, thus, clay dat I remains clay, and siam in Icelandic progressed to sj JJ and WW of Proto-Germanic became GGJ and GGV respectively in Old Norse. A change known as Holtzmann's law epenthesis and epenthetic vowel became popular by 1200 in Old Danish, 1250 in Old Swedish and Norwegian, and 1300 in Old Icelandic. An unstressed vowel was used which varied by dialect. Old Norwegian exhibited all three. U was used in West Norwegian south of Bergen, as in aftor, after older aptr, north of Bergen. I appeared in after, after, and East Norwegian used a, after, after grammar. Old Norse was a moderately inflected language with high levels of nominal and verbal inflection. Most of the fused morphemes are retained in modern Icelandic, especially in regard to noun case declensions, whereas modern Norwegian in comparison has moved towards more analytical word structures. Gender. Further information, grammatical gender. Old Norse had three grammatical genders, masculine, feminine and neuter. Adjectives or pronouns referring to a noun must mirror the gender of that noun, so that one says, heil mar, but, heil barn, like in other languages, the grammatical gender of an impersonal noun is generally unrelated to an expected natural gender of that noun. While indeed Karl, man, is masculine, kona, woman, is feminine, and hus, house, is neuter, so also are hrafn and kraka, for raven, and crow, masculine and feminine respectively. Even in reference to a female raven or a male crow, all neuter words have identical nominative and accusative forms, and all feminine words have identical nominative and accusative plurals. The gender of some words' plurals does not agree with that of their singulars, such as limb and mun. Some words, such as hunger, have multiple genders, evidenced by their determiners being declined in different genders within a given sentence hierarchy. Old Norse inherited the Proto-Germanic feature of having neuter as the default gender. This means that when the gender of a noun is unknown, adjectives and pronouns referencing it use the neuter gender forms, rather than the masculine or feminine. Thus, if speaking or writing to a general audience, one would say velkommit, well as it come, rather than velkommen or velkommen, well as come, as one does not know whether the person hearing it is going to be male or female. One generally sees adjectives in their neuter form when used pronominally. For this reason, for words more commonly used in this way rather than to describe a noun, one sees their neuter forms more often than their masculine or feminine. Normally the masculine form would be the most beneficial form of an adjective to learn first, given that the majority of nouns are masculine in these cases. However, the most practical form to learn first would be the neuter morphology. Main article, Old Norse morphology. Nouns, adjectives and pronouns were declined in four grammatical cases, nominative, accusative, genitive and dative. In singular and plural numbers, adjectives and pronouns were additionally declined in three grammatical genders. Some pronouns first and second person could have dual number in addition to singular and plural. The genitive is used partitively, and quite often in compounds and kennings, e.g., Arerbrunnar, the well of Lokasenna, the gibing of Loki. There were several classes of nouns within each gender. The following is an example of the strong inflectional paradigms. The strong masculine noun armr, English arm, case singular plural. Nominative armr, armar, accusative arm, arma, genitive arms, arma, dative army, armum, armum, the feminine noun hall, own, hall, oen, English hall, case singular plural. Nominative hall, hall. Haller, haller, oen, accusative hall, hall, haller, haller, oen, genitive haller, halla, dative hallu, hallu, hallum, hallum, the neuter noun troll, English troll, case singular plural. Nominative troll, troll, accusative troll, troll, genitive trolls, trolla, dative trolli, trollum. In addition to these examples, there were the numerous weak noun paradigms, which had a much higher degree of syncretism between the different cases in its paradigms, i.e. they had fewer forms than the strong nouns. A definite article was realized as a suffix that retained an independent declension, e.g. trolla, troll, trollet, the troll, halla, hall, hallin, the hall, armr, an arm, armrin, the arm. This definite article, however, was a separate word and did not become attached to the noun before later stages of the Old Norse period texts. Wikimedia Commons has media related to Old Norse. Manuscripts. The earliest inscriptions in Old Norse are runic. From the 8th century, runes continued to be commonly used until the 15th century and have been recorded to be in use in some form as late as the 19th century in some parts of Sweden. With the conversion to Christianity in the 11th century came the Latin alphabet. The oldest preserved texts in Old Norse in the Latin alphabet date from the middle of the 12th century. Subsequently, Old Norse became the vehicle of a large and varied body of vernacular literature, unique in medieval Europe. Most of the surviving literature was written in Iceland. Best known are the Norse sagas, the Icelanders' sagas, and the mythological literature, but there also survives a large body of religious literature, translations into Old Norse of courtly romances, classical mythology, and the Old Testament, as well as instructional material, grammatical treatises, and a large body of letters and official documents. Dialects. Most of the innovations that appeared in Old Norse spread evenly through the Old Norse area. As a result, the dialects were very similar and considered to be the same language, a language that they sometimes called the Danish tongue Dansk Tunga, sometimes Norse language Norrønt Mal, as evidenced in the following two quotes from Heimskringla by Snorri Sturluson: Moir digva var drot, dotter danpis konungs, sonar rigs fyrstrvar konunger kalder.